time at Big Cat Rescue. Oh, did I make you nervous? He doesn't know which cart to follow. Two carts going by at one time. So many choices. For you, you're stopping for you. She sure has a good appetite for such an old girl. Feeding Dryden and Kelowna right now, and those are pretty spooky cats, so I'm not going to interrupt them. Maybe we'll go over and see Tonga having his breakfast. I strapped the 360 camera to Howie, and he's 6'4", so it's going to be a different view than most people get. But he's giving a tour to the Animal Legal Defense Fund today, and I thought that would be a really interesting tour to preserve in 360. All those amazing students who are working to save big cats, devoting their lives to animal law. Hey, Tonga. Did you already eat all your breakfast? Did I miss the whole breakfast? I guess I might have. Yep, just crumbs left. There are some crumbs though, you could have those. There goes Nala. And I just saw Dryden go by. Way back there in the background. for everybody who's just going to lose their mind about the size of the cage that he's in, that's a feeding lockout. It's just where he gets his breakfast. That is not his cage. He's got well over 1,200 square feet here that he can roam. Nala is all about the food. Who is that going to?
This is going to Ariel. Some yummy breakfast.
A lot of bobcat food. Yeah, there it is, Ariel. Woohoo! You think something's up too. Everybody's so nervous. What's going on? They just want to clean cages today, that's it. Well, Nala's not shy. Yes, this is Nala Serval. Looks like she's eating a chicken breast. Ariel still hasn't come out to eat. you everybody for sharing. It really helps us reach more people. Everybody needs to see cats having breakfast. Hey, Michael Heath. I'm assuming you helped Elisa with the Explore camera meltdown in the tour waiting area yesterday, so thank you for that. And it's gone. In Silly area, oh, there's a good breakfast waiting for you right there. So are y'all picking up what they haven't eaten now?
Correct, yep.
And then for some of the cats, they'll actually go and weigh it to make sure that they eat as much as they should, and if not, then they'll get a second chance later on. We'll head out and see if we can find another group of feeders. You left some nibbles. Greasy Bobcat left some nibbles.
Yep, little scratch.
Not much, though. Bobcat ate all her breakfast. For some reason, they're trying to move Thurston and Lovey down to one side of their ginormous enclosure. They've got three enclosures that are 1,200 square feet each. And Lovey is like, I know there's something up. I'm not going to do that. And every cat around here is watching like, what's going on? What are they doing? Why are they trying to catch them? They're not trying to catch them, they're just trying to move them to one side. They're so suspicious. Wonder if the big cats have eaten yet. I see Manny. Manny Jaguar. Not falling for it.
She's not falling for it now.
Maybe if I get my cart out of here. I'm leaving. I'm not there. It's rich. Good morning. Sorry, everybody, for that spin around. It looks like you got a very good offering there.
Yeah.
Keisha Tiger.
She's in love. She's a love kitty.
Are you in love with Rich?
In love with her.
Anything male.
Oh, she says, I'm in the camera.
Is it embarrassing to eat on film? 807 people are waiting for you to eat that chicken leg.
Right there. Don't Would you like something different?
They bring a whole array of things to try and tempt the cats.
Pork! We got some pork! Pork!
Mm. Drive by, yummy, drive through window for pork.
Nope, not for me.
What if we come all the way down here?
Keisha!
Keisha Tiger!
Could you get a drink?
Your neighbor will eat it. Look at that, right there! No thanks! Right there! Camera shy? Where you going? Is it better if I stand up? Here, look, it's really up high.
Maybe you rub it all over your chest so it smells like you. Would you like it better if it smells like a man? Breathe on it. He breathed on it. Smell that.
I know you'll eat it. Your neighbor wants it. Buzzards want it.
Yeah.
Come on, look at right here. Look at that. Thanks for saying hi.
When Keisha Tiger arrived, she was already missing her tail and one ear, and you can tell her stripes don't match up on her back left leg or back right leg. So apparently there had been some damage there at some point that healed kind of wrong. But she was so skinny when she came that we did not spay her on arrival, and then she's lived by herself all these years, so we haven't had any reason to spay her, and now she's like ancient, and so we're afraid to spay her, but she goes into heat all the time, and when she's in heat she doesn't want to eat, so it takes a lot of coaxing and patience, and thank goodness for volunteers like Rich that are willing to spend the time to try and get enough food in her.
Ooh, that was close.
We don't do any breeding here because none of the cats that are in captivity can ever go free. And there's just no reason to breed them for life in prison.
Look at that!
We're about 45 minutes from Orlando, so if you come to see Mickey Mouse, you definitely need to come see the cats.
Look at that! Yummy, yummy, yummy! Yummy, yummy, yummy!
Kate wants to know how long they stay in heat. You probably know better than I do.
I would almost say like 2 weeks.
2 weeks?
And then they're out for a week and they're back.
Yeah.
With her.
There is that problem. Just keeps happening. I can't show you your witness protection cat.
Are you working up an appetite?
I hope so.
Are you working up an appetite?
That noise she's making is called chuffing. The noise Rich is making is an attempt at chuffing. And that's Tiger Talk for hello, how are you? It's a polite sound.
Almost. You thought about it.
It doesn't always stop them from going into heat. We've had cats who were fixed here that still went into heat. I don't even know how that's physically possible, except that they were just so accustomed to doing it.
Don't eat it.
How long was she in captivity before she came here? I don't remember off the top of my head, but if there is anybody here who is an extreme explorer and knows that question, her bio is at bigcatrescue.org/Keisha, K-E-I-S-H-A, and it'll tell you her date of birth and the date of rescue, so you can do the math to figure out how old she was when she got here. And then it'll also tell you the, if you do the math for today's date, she's you'll done. Know how old she is. All right, she's through. I see somebody back here in the background. Looks like maybe they're feeding caracals. We can go see how that's going. Peaceful here in the morning. The dew's on the ground. The cats are getting breakfast. I see Chaos eating her breakfast. Don't want to disturb her. Chaos is a caracal. You can hear in the background. Jamie, we feed them every morning, and then the cats like Keisha and Cameron and Arthur and Andre, those guys that don't eat very well, they get fed several times a day. Kathy? I would not live where it snows. I just couldn't do it. Did it once. Hated it. This is definitely their happy time of day. They love breakfast time. I didn't see the question, but it sounded like the answer was about how many volunteers we have. We have 130 volunteers, and usually anywhere from 6 to 22 interns. Interns are here 6 days a week. The volunteers might only come in once a week, or twice a week, but because there's 130 of them, they get a lot of work done. And there are 70 cats. Makia, there are 70 cats. Rhonda, thank you for that pitch for the Big Cat Public Safety Act. That really can save thousands of animals, and it will save so many cubs from being ripped from their moms and used as pay-to-play props, where people pay to have their picture made with a cub. And then they get dumped when they're about 12 weeks old, and usually in horrible situations. Sometimes they end up in canned hunts where they're shot for a fee. Sometimes they end up in pseudo-medicinals, the black market, backyards of people who can't even afford to feed their children, much less feed a big cat. I think you got it all, Chaos. You ate every bit. Every bit. And I'm willing to bet that your handsome Cyrus has eaten all of his food. I see Diablo over there, but he's probably not going to let me get close. Where's Diablo? I'm going to go around so I don't scare him. There's no way I can go through there without getting too close to him. The first two feeders I was following this morning, that was Steve and MC. Oh dear, dueling servals. They're being all hissy. Being so hissy. The one on the left is Hutch. He's a new serval. He just came from a wildlife rehab center down in Jupiter. We don't rehab and release servals because they're from Africa. So he was not part of their primary mission.
Yeah, I think Manny's on the back. I know that it's hard. Some people put him on the center. Some people put him on the back. Have you noticed Hutch is doing the serval neck arching?
Yeah, they said when I went to pick him up that that was something he did a lot.
Usually the only ones that do it, I mean, well, of course it's just servals, but when it goes from cold to hot,
yeah,
that's when it seems to happen.
And they're so much further south of us, I was surprised to hear that would happen there.
Hmm. Well, maybe that'll help us give a clue to what it is. They're like, well, I was surprised that it was on the drop down. I said, that means it's happened before.
It Mark? Used to be called that weird neck arching thing.
Weird.
I don't know if it's still.
No, now it's just neck arching.
Because it's not so weird. We see it.
So Mark is training on how to feed big.
Manny says, I'm a big.
Yeah. Manny says, I want everybody to feed. I wonder if Catherine ever got Lovey to go over.
As of a few minutes ago, no.
He was so easy. Yeah, he just got freaked out all of a sudden.
She took everybody with her. Like, Ariel won't come out to eat. She's like, oh, something's up. Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
Ariel won't come out either? That's so weird.
Row?
Yeah, look. She says, I didn't get any food. That's because you didn't leave anything. You already ate it all. Hi, Missy. Hi. I know. Now, when I do Matt and Maya, I usually don't move this because they get big things. With Armani, I move it because she gets small stuff and you have to spread it around on the plate.
Makes sense.
Why does she get small stuff?
Because she tries to eat it all at once without chewing and chokes on it.
And you guys have that cut up like Bobcat size.
Oh, yeah. She just gets little stuff. We just put it all over the tray. Not too close to the edge because she likes to knock things over like most of the cats. Oops. Oops. How's the baby girl? I haven't seen you for a while. Huh? I have not seen you. best leopard girl. Huh? Oh, sorry, Sunny.
Sunny thought you were talking to her anyway. Surely she's talking to me. Can you tell people why the door's down?
Awfully close. All the big cats, clawed or not, get their doors locked. So our hands aren't anywhere. This looks a lot like a chicken quarter or a chicken leg. Safe for us, safe for them. Back and make sure she eats everything. Oh, look at the belly. Look at that belly on you. Oh, that belly looks like your Uncle Simba. He has quite the belly.
We have seen, because we were one of them, cats are eating.
Vultures in my backyard.
Vultures?
They followed me home.
Could you take the rest of them with you?
They're trying to eat my stray cat.
Oh, no. Vultures have become such a huge problem. That's why we have to have that wire around the cages, because they will intimidate our cats. 200 of them at a time will fly in and circle around that feeding lockout if they think there's any chance they're going to get one nibble of meat. So we have to have people stand there with the cats while they eat. We have to put those fine mesh wire things around the food so that even when the cats are done eating and there's a little scratch or left, that the vultures can't get any of it. We have sprinkler systems that go off every hour. And I understand it's really awful for farmers as well, because they will actually take the baby animals and kill them. I've seen them out here with the mama ducks. They'll attack the mama ducks and steal all of the babies after they've been hatched. It's hard for me to imagine why that is a necessary protective species, but it's so devastating to everything around it. Doing the Brandon, there are no Florida panthers here. The cougar, mountain lion, Florida panther, it's all the same DNA. But the difference with the Florida panther is that it's a much more inbred variety. And they're usually much smaller than like a big western cougar. Like you. Like this beautiful cougar. Yeah. Beautiful Orion. Who's purring after his breakfast. I hear some people talking about the cages. You're only seeing a very small snapshot of what the cages are. This cage here is actually three cages. Each cage is 1,200 square feet. They're all three hooked together, so that's 3,600 square feet. Plus, there's this long tunnel over there, if you can see it, that hooks this one to the two over there. There might even be three over there. And that's for these three siblings who live together. You can find out more about our cages at bigcatrescue.org/cages. But we absolutely agree that cats don't belong in cages in the first place. And if that's really what you feel, then please do something about it. Go to bigcatact.com and we make it so, so easy for you to send an email or to call, which is like sending 200 emails. It's so much more powerful. You're a member of Congress, and we actually dial the phone number for you. So when you fill out your information and you say, call me, we dial it. It goes through. It's the weekend. You're going to get an answering machine, so it's not going to be scary. And you just leave a message saying, please ask your boss to champion the Big Cat Public Safety Act. That's all you have to do. It's a purring, purring, purring. The only cats who can ever go to the wild are those who were born in the wild. And these guys were born in cages, and they were mostly born in cages because of evil people who will breed them and pimp them out to ignorant people who will pay to touch them. And I say ignorant, not cruel, because they just don't know. Usually the people who pay to have their picture made with a cub are people who really love cubs. They really love cats, that's why they want to touch them. But they don't understand that what they're doing is causing so much harm and so much abuse and is actually killing the cat's chance of survival in the wild because it provides a legal smokescreen for all kinds of illegal activities. But once those people figure out that they have been lied to, that none of those cats that are born in cages are ever going to be set free and that they're never going to serve any conservation value, then they become some of the most staunch advocates for protecting big cats. Hi! So we try to be nice to people even who come here and act all nasty to us because they just don't know any better until they learn the issues. And once they learn the issues, then they become voices for these cats. To stop the captivity. We do rehab and release of native-born cats, but only cats who were born in the wild can go back to the wild. So that's in Florida. That's only bobcats and Florida panthers. We don't have any Florida panthers here. All of our tiger pool, tiger cages have these pools. Yes, Ra'u. Yes. The water comes up from the 18-acre lake through a pipe. You can see it spilling into the pool there, and then it goes through an overflow and then back out to the lake. So they always have fresh water to swim in. This is just their swimming water. And then each cage has at least two bowls for their drinking water, and those get changed out completely every day and scrubbed. There are six of these cages. Each one of these cages, the tiger cages, are 1,800 square feet. There are six of them along this bank here, but they were built at a time when we were rescuing a bunch of cats from the circus. So we had to make space very quickly for cats, but now we have fewer tigers. Can you guys hear Gabrielle? Ah, she stopped doing it. So what we've done is given each tiger on what we call Tiger Row here two cages. So each tiger has 3,600 square feet instead of just 1,800 square feet, which means they have two pools, two dens, at least two feeding lockouts, usually four. There's usually one per section. I think we've seen most of the feeding. It's hard to see all of it because it goes on simultaneously, different people in different sections. But if they're doing the feeding tour now, which was what Honey and Fred were doing, then that means all the other cats have pretty much been fed. And I see Matt headed out to clean, which is another indicator that everybody's been fed. So now what'll happen is our 130 so volunteers, everybody who's here today anyway, will go out, see how much food the cats left behind. They will make a notation of it if it's an unusual amount, and they will then go out and start cleaning all of the cages, scrubbing those feeding platforms and scrubbing the bowls and changing the water out. And then usually about 2 o'clock, they'll go out and start handing out enrichment. Every day the cats get some kind of enrichment, which is really nice for them to have something different to do. And then the tours will be out at about 3 o'clock. Around 4:30, 5 o'clock, they'll go out and do evening meds. And evening snacks for the cats who didn't eat well this morning. And we're going to be doing a bunch of projects today as well. I have a bunch of work to do myself, so I'm going to head back to that. Thank you, everybody, who was here today, and all of you who are helping to answer questions and helping to educate those who don't know any better, those who have been brought here because of the people who pimp out cubs and tell them lies. Thank you for answering their questions and being so patient with them, because they will become your best friends and your best allies in this work to save the cats once they get the truth. So thank you so much, everybody. I will talk to you guys later.